Hi, I'm Rob Baumann, the Chief Technologist for High Reliability. If you want to know more about TI's space products after this video, please visit ti.com/space. Thanks for watching. And in this lecture, we'll be talking about total ionizing dose and its effect in MOSFETs. Okay, so basically the total ionizing dose mechanism is related to hole trapping in the oxides. That's the primary mode that it affects MOSFETs. There's also the creation of interface states. So just to calibrate everyone, this is a band diagram of the metal oxide semiconductor structure. And so we have the gate electrode on the left, we have the gate oxide in the middle, and then the silicon interface, and then the silicon substrate to the right. So obviously in the horizontal dimension, we're talking about the depth or linear extent of the device vertically. In the vertical direction, we have energy, and this is electron energy as we go up in the vertical dimension. So we put a positive gate voltage, which pulls down the gate, and we have this slant across the oxide, or an electric field across the oxide. What that means is any electrons in the conduction band will run down this slant and be collected by the gate. Again, electrons are attracted to the positive gate voltage. In a complementary fashion, the holes, or positively charged defects, will be traveling in the opposite direction, floating like bubbles up the slant, if you will. Now, when these devices are exposed to radiation, any radiation that's absorbed creates electron hole pairs. And so you get a separation of the hole state and the electron, and of course they're accelerated in opposing directions. Now there's one feature of gate oxides that makes them particularly sensitive to total dose effects, is that the electron mobility, or how effectively it can be moved, is much higher than that of holes. So in the presence of the electric field, the electrons in the conduction band are very quickly removed, leaving us with a distribution of holes throughout the gate oxide. Now they're not completely immobile, but they move slowly by a hopping mechanism, as shown by these green arrows. So they're actually falling into low-level traps, low-level meaning low-energy traps, right along the valence band edge, and they, in a hopping motion, they go from trap to trap to trap as they go towards the interface. Again, we have the positive gate voltage, so that's pushing these holes up the hill, if you will. Now, because these traps often have hydrogen or protons bound in them, when the hole moves into the trap, it releases some of the hydrogen. So actually, we have a dual effect of holes moving to the right, and as they release protons or hydrogen ions, these hydrogen ions are also accelerated by the field to move to the right. Now, the two particles do two different things, and they affect devices in a different way. Once the holes come close to the interface, there's a large population of so-called deep level traps. These are traps that are somewhere in the middle of the band gap. So the band gap, again, is in the gate oxide, is the distance between the valence to the conduction band. And these deep traps, so-called deep traps, are right in the middle of the band gap. So the holes move down towards the interface and then are trapped in the gate oxide. So this is a quasi-static kind of or quasi-stable trapping state, so that the holes are then captured in the gate oxide and are no longer free to move. In a similar fashion, the proton transport continues until the protons reach the interface, where they actually generate so-called interface state defects, which can be positively charged, negatively charged, or neutral, depending on the type of defect. Now, these are particularly important for bipolar junction transistors, not so important for MOSFETs. It's really the positive charge trapping, as we'll see, that dominates most MOSFET behavior. Okay, so on the diagram on the left, I show basically an NMOS or N-channel device. So remember, that's basically where we have N-type material for the source and the drain. And N-type material is just shorthand for negative or electron-rich materials, because we remember electrons are negative. And the channel region, in this state it's off, is P-type or positive, so we have some holes. Now, we won't get any conduction unless we get some electrons in the channel. And so in typical NMOS operation, we apply a positive gate voltage, and then as you can see, we invert the surface layer and we get a high concentration of electrons due to the field effect under the gate. Now, this high concentration of electrons effectively connects our source to the drain. We get a large conduction and the transistor is on, okay, channel conducting. Now, when the device is exposed to a total dose type exposure, we'll get many radiation events here, denoted by yellow arrows. And you'll note that every time a yellow arrow transverses the oxide, we get the creation of positive charge. Again, this is the hole traps near the interface, trapped in deep level traps. And you can see the effect of the holes is going to be to attract more electrons. Or you can think about it, it's as if you've applied a slightly positive gate voltage. In fact, in very bad cases where you've generated a tremendous amount of charge, you can turn off the gate voltage. So we just turned off the gate voltage and the channel remains. So this is a very leaky transistor. So the N channel is still on even though we've turned off the gate. So a poster for this is basically the picture on the right, which shows a leaky faucet. So in fact, total ionizing charge creates a leaky NMOS transistor. So basically, this transistor becomes harder and harder to turn off. As you continue to increase the dose exposure, you get more and more charge, and eventually you get to a condition where the transistor no longer functions. Now, CMOS is complementary NMOS and PMOS devices combined. And so as you would expect, since the PMOS is the complement or opposite of the NMOS device, the effect of total dose is the opposite, as we said. So I'm not going to go through this whole series of slides as we did previously, but I just want to show that in this case, the drain and source are positive or hole type material. The N substrate is, of course, negatively charged or electron rich. And if we want to create a channel, in other words, if we want to turn on this device, we basically have to apply a negative gate voltage, attract some holes, and connect the source and drain regions. Unfortunately, the presence of positive charge here is going to effectively turn off our PMOS. So our PMOS transistor, or P-channel, actually stays off even if the gate voltage is brought down to ground, which for the PMOS is the on state. So this is post-irradiation. We can't turn the transistor on. So you can think of total dose, or total ionizing dose charge effect on the PMOS transistor is like a rusty faucet. Basically, it becomes harder and harder to get any current to flow until finally the transistor doesn't work anymore. Okay, so in CMOS, as I said, we have an N-channel device and a P-channel device. Again, the P-channel device gets harder to turn on, so it becomes less leaky with dose, whereas the N-channel becomes more and more leaky. Well, I wasn't very specific about where the leakage is coming from. In the examples I stated in the previous slides, we were talking about mid-channel conduction between the source and drain regions. But as you can see in this diagram, there are two other pathways for charge to leak. In fact, if the isolation becomes charged, and here the isolating layer or insulating layer between the two transistors is the so-called shallow trench isolation. That's one of two types, and I'll talk about the two types in a later slide. But this red region is very large volume and can capture a tremendous amount of charge, which then under an electric field can accumulate at edges or right at the side of the channel. So you get a potential leakage path along 3 as well as a leakage path under the isolation to the N well, as shown in leakage path 2. So what does the IV look like? Well, this is an N-channel IV. The blue curves represent the N-channel by itself, presuming that there's no isolation leakage. So the first curve here, pre-rad, the blue curve, is a typical NMOS characteristic. We turn the gate-to-source voltage positive, we attract electrons in the channel, and we connect the source and drain and get a high conductance state. Now once we've irradiated the device, and again, we've generated positive charge, so the threshold voltage drops. You can see the curve shifts to the left. That's expected, and that implies that the transistor is starting to leak, or that it's more easy to turn on. For a smaller gate voltage, you get the same amount of conductance. In modern transistors, by modern I mean sub 100 angstrom or 200 angstrom thick gate oxides, this effect is minimal, so the VT shift can almost be ignored for most applications. Where leakage becomes important now is mechanisms 2 and 3, which are defined by the green curve. This is the isolation leakage, and so it's the parasitic transistor caused by this overlapping gate over the isolation can turn on the isolation leakage. And with radiation, this curve shifts to the left. So this green curve without radiation doesn't turn on until 8 volts, which for this particular technology would be very good isolation. However, once we expose it to radiation, positive charge is trapped, and in the NMOS areas, you get tremendous amount of leakage. And you'll note this isolation leakage, so let's say at 0 volts, under normal circumstances, again, we're looking at the blue curves here, the leakage for this NMOS transistor is somewhere around, say, 5 or 6 picoamps. However, due to the isolation leakage after irradiation, we're in the microamp range. So nearly 6 orders of magnitude leakage. And this really can spell disaster for devices as IDDQ increases off scale and you lose functionality. So the key way that total dose actually damages CMOS devices, at least modern devices, is by mechanism 3 or 2, where isolation leakage dominates, and basically we fail either because of a current specification or actual circuit functionality. Okay, now I did kind of allude to the shallow trench isolation, but I didn't mention the other type. There's 2 types of isolation. The first that was kind of developed was local field oxidation, or LOCOS, for localized field oxidation. This is basically a grown oxide, and it has a very distinctive shape. Okay, so because silicon is consumed as the oxide grows, you get some depth penetration of the oxide, but also the oxide rises above the silicon level. The problem is right here at the edge of the oxide. There's a so-called bird's beak region, which concentrates the field and actually captures a lot of the charge or accumulates a lot of the positive charge in this area. So guess what? Since you have a lot of positive charge accumulation here, you're going to affect the silicon substrate underneath and cause channels of leakage right at the edge of the isolation. And indeed, that's the biggest failure mode for local field oxidation or LOCOS, so-called LOCOS. Now, the other type of isolation I mentioned, it's more common in modern technologies. This is the shallow trench isolation. And basically, this is different. It's not a grown oxide. Basically, we dig a trench between the transistors to isolate them, and then we backfill the trench with layers of oxide and other dielectrics. Now, this can also have issues right at the edge if the electric field lines get too concentrated, or depending on the layers, the different layers that are used, you can have charge accumulation. So using STI is no guarantee of performance, but as you'll see on the plot on the right-hand side, this is a paper out of Sandia. They took several or many commercial technologies and did total dose testing on them. And they divided the technologies by those which were LOCOS, this local oxidation type, and shallow trench isolation. And clearly, the shallow trench isolation has a big leg up on total dose performance. So the yellow line is showing us about 100K, or the yellow region is something below 100K rad. And as said here, 100K rad is great for most space applications, even 50K rad. But LOCOS has trouble getting, in some cases, above 10K rad, as you can see from these lower points. Once you move to the shallow trench isolation, typically you can get in the hundreds of K-rads. Now, I should mention these are also lower voltage technologies. And as you recall from the original band diagram and discussions around total ionizing dose, the electric field is very important for defining the effect. So if we have a higher voltage part, it's going to be more sensitive to total dose because it can move more of that charge. Okay, so to close up, as we mentioned, the key driver on this effect is the trapping of holes, positive charge, in the oxide that acts like a positive gate voltage. The NMOS becomes more leaky, in other words, less gate voltage is required to turn it on, while the PMOS becomes harder to turn on, and more gate voltage is required to turn it on. And fundamentally, the functional failure comes about because the NMOS begins to leak more and more, and eventually your current specification has failed, or in extreme cases, you fail functionality. Leakage comes from both gate oxide, as we saw direct gate oxide, so the channel region becoming leaky between the source and the gate, and also isolation leakage. And as I said, in advanced CMOS technologies where the oxide is thinner than 200 angstroms, there's just not enough charge to accumulate in such a small volume. So basically, the isolation leakage dominates. So again, the shallow trench isolation or the locus isolation that we talked about collects a lot more charge and then concentrates it in certain high field areas, and basically isolation leakage is the primary failure mechanism. And as a rule of thumb, shallow trench isolation is usually more robust than locus to total dose, at least at low VDD. Thank you for your attention.